Hi, it's Dr. Lori. I'm back with more real bargains. You know what they are. When people just like you find something at the thrift store, the yard sale, the flea market, they send me a picture, I identify it, and show them the real bargains. There are a lot of great ones. You can find this. You can do this. And a lot of people will say, oh, no, you can't find anything. There's nothing at the thrift stores. It's all junk. It's all there. It's all there. And I want you to learn it right here. Okay, anyway, here are some of our real bargain stories. Remember, all the folks who have submitted these objects, whether through a video call or my online appraisals or sending me a photo, whatever it might be, my priority service, I've gotten permission. I've asked their permission to retell their stories, and I'm using a pseudonym, so a fake name, not their real names, just to protect their privacy. So here's the first one. This is Tom, we'll call him. Tom goes to an estate sale. He said it was his first estate sale. I was really happy. I talked to him on a video call after he sent a piece to through the send a photo on our website. And I'm on the video call, and he's a really nice guy, young guy and nice guy. He goes, Dr. Lori, I've been watching your videos and you say I can do this. So I went to my first estate sale. So he goes to his first estate sale, and he went to an estate sale, 5-6 acres, big estate sale of a antique dealer who had passed away. So he was looking through Harold Fisher magazines. He's looking through these American Illustration magazines. He's looking through stacks of magazines. He's looking at this, looking at that. His wife's with him. I think they have little kids. So little kids were there, whatever, walking around, looking for things. And he decides, you know what, I'm going to spend $20 for this stack of magazines. And he goes up, he goes to pay for them. And, you know, he's kind of excited. He bought his first thing at the estate sale. And the stack of magazines, as he's going through, an object, a print, kind of falls out of the stack of magazines. So it falls out of the stack of magazines, and the guy says, well, it's $20 for all the magazines, and oh, that print, oh yeah, and he doesn't really look at it as he's charged, as he's, you know, cashing him out, cashing Tom out. And he goes, oh, well, that's torn anyway. Well, you can just have that for free. You can just have that torn piece for free. So he takes the stack of magazines, he takes the print that is torn home, and he starts to do a little bit of research, and he sees that it's Christ in the temple, the presentation in the temple. If you remember your Bible stories, I grew up Catholic. We didn't do a lot of Bible stories. We did a lot of, you know, the crucifixion, the body and blood, and this kind of thing. Bible stories are more associated really with sort of studying the Bible. So anyway, presentation in the Bible, the presentation in the temple, of course, Christ here in the temple is this image. So as Tom does a little more research, he starts to realize that there's some kind of interesting things about this print, which is signed Rembrandt from, of course, the middle part of the 1600s, signed in the actual print. Now, remember, there's a big tear in this print. There's a big tear in the paper, pretty good, significant size tear. So he does a little bit more research. He sends me a picture. He says, Dr. Lori, I really need a written appraisal, an online appraisal from you for it. And he recognizes something that looks like a watermark. Now, I'll tell you a very short story. When I was at Penn State, I was working in the museums called the Palmer Museum of Art with a very lovely and very highly skilled Rembrandt expert. And she was the director of the museum. She was a wonderful person. She was very good to me for years and years and years. She was my mentor for years in graduate school. And she, in fact, is a scholar in Rembrandt, and we helped to put together a Rembrandt exhibition. She told me, look for the watermarks. So I'm looking for stains of water. That's what I thought a watermark was. I know you're going to think, God, Dr. Lori, I thought you were smarter than this. Well, I wasn't. I didn't know what this was. So I had to understand and start to learn watermarks, specifically these marks that are put into paper. So it's not a stain like a water stain. It's a watermark. And the mark actually is within the part of the paper. So looking at the paper is really important. The other thing about Rembrandt pieces that I learned from her and others over the years and years and years of doing this, is that there's something called chain lining in the paper, which actually shows you how the mechanization is, the mechanics that are used to make this kind of paper, and you can actually see this particular type of chain lining. This is another thing that starts to tell you, yes, you really have an authentic piece. So this is what actually Tom found, and that what I confirmed, was called the Strasbourg lily mark, the Strasbourg lily watermark. It's very well known in the circles of course, Rembrandt authenticators and, of course, art historians and others. Having said that, the Strasbourg lily also has an AM for Amsterdam in the middle of the mark. And it's very difficult to see the mark, but if you hold it up to the light, you can actually see it. And on today's papers, like Reeves papers or Arches papers, if you see a more contemporary print, you can actually see the word Reeves or the Arches. And you can see these sort of emblems that relate to who made the paper. So this starts to tell me, okay, this particular piece really is the real deal. It's a piece from, of course, the latter part of the 1630s into the 1640s when Rembrandt is actually working in Leiden and in Amsterdam. This is really important, unbelievable. So as you look at this particular piece, and as I looked at it and tried to identify it for Tom, I'm sitting there going, oh my gosh, he got this for free. Despite the rip in the paper, this particular piece is called the Second State. And what that means is it's an oblong piece of paper and it's different states. Rembrandt, like many artists, would actually make a particular print and then impress that print onto paper, right? Print it out, and then he changed the plate that he was pressing into the piece of paper in some way. The first one he did is called the First State. Anytime you change the plate again and you make any kind of changes to the image, it's called the Second State, and the Third State is when you change it again, and so on and so on. So you'll see this thing about states. So if you don't know that, that's just sort of printing terms, and I'll try to teach you all this as we go on. So he gets this. It's his first estate sale. He's really psyched, and lo and behold, what he has found and got for free, because the guy who, of course, is checking him out just doesn't care about that ripped old print, it's worth $10,000. $10,000 is what he got. Now you're going, but it's ripped, Dr. Lori, but it's ripped. I know it's ripped. I saw that it's ripped. What's the end of this story? He brought it to his local museum. They connected him with a professional restorer, and they're conserving that piece. They've rescued this Rembrandt print. It's getting conserved, restored by a professional. Yes, he had to put some money into that, and he's going to frame it up and keep it in his home. That's a great, great, real bargain. This is Joe's story. Joe is another pseudonym for one of my clients, a priority member. Joe goes to a thrift store where the way he buys his pieces are by the pound. So you pay by the pound. So it's basically all about the weight. So you can put anything in and then they go, okay, put it on a scale. How much does it weigh? All right, you can go. So that's basically how they do it. They do it by the pound at this particular thrift store. So Joe goes in and he's looking through things and he likes to get things that don't weigh a lot, right? Makes sense. So you want to make sure you have things that don't weigh a lot. So he gets this particular piece out of a Goodwill or thrift store bin. And he looks at this piece, he says, it's kind of a pretty picture. It's a black and white picture. I call it a gelatin silver print for the specific name. It's a black and white print photograph, about 14 by 11. And it's of a snowy landscape, a tree with actually a mountain in the background. Well, he sends this to me through our priority service where he gets unlimited appraisals. And, I'm typing back to him and I said, where did you get this? And he says, oh, I'm sorry, Dr. Lure, I wanted to show you the back. The back has a brownish color from acid burning. So I type back and I go, okay, well, the acid burning isn't so unusual. It's fine. And he says, well, I got this at a thrift store and I paid 25 cents for it if you kind of extrapolate out how much I paid because I paid for it by the weight. You know, I paid for it that way. So I said, okay. I said, do you know who this is by? He said, well, it is signed at the bottom and it looks like Ansel Adams signed it. And I said, Ansel Adams did sign it. It's an Ansel Adams gelatin silver print from 1940, the very famous winter landscape of Yosemite, of course, called Half Dome Tree in Winter. And it's a relatively well-known piece. It's been published many times, and it is an actual signed piece of Ansel Adams, a great piece of American photography. And as you well know, Ansel Adams, who is a child in San Francisco at the great San Francisco earthquake. And then he goes on to have an illustrious career, of course, throughout the 40s and 50s and such in photography, black and white landscape photography. He's a quintessential master. What's this piece worth from the 25 cent investment? $3,500. That was a real bargain for Joe. On a video call, I talked to Meg, and Meg actually had something that a lot of you guys have. Even my family has some of these, and these are Beanie Babies. Now, a lot of you ask me about Beanie Babies oftentimes, and actually, I think about one of my relatives who actually puts the Beanie Babies up on the Christmas tree, and the reason why they do that, because they have little tiny dogs and little tiny kids, and they don't want anybody to get hurt with Christmas ornaments that might be broken or glass or such. So instead, they put Beanie Babies up on the Christmas tree. You might have seen this. And all the different ones are pretty interesting. So one of the years at Christmas, you know, I've told them, you better look at those before you go putting them up on the tree and letting the kids play with them. But this particular one is the story of Meg. And Meg had this piece, and she's been collecting them since she was a young person. So this is the typical story of, oh, I've got a tub of Beanie Babies in my basement, and I want Dr. Lori to tell me which ones are valuable. Some of them were valuable, and some of them were not. Some of them were a couple bucks. They were kind of run-of-the-mill. And some of the ones in Meg's tub that she did during a video call with me were actually worth some money. This particular one is an iguana, right? It's called Iggy, and this particular one has particular pellets. It had good condition. A lot of these so-called Beanie Baby experts don't even look at condition. They only look at tags and look at errors and such. And this particular one was a real find. She was really excited to find out that this one, not made in China, by the way, made in Indonesia, is worth $250 for one Beanie Baby. That's a real bargain. This next real bargain is from someone who is a volunteer at a thrift store. Volunteers at thrift stores, you know, people are doing good work with respect to thrift stores. They, of course, are trying to help people get jobs, this kind of thing. So this person volunteers his time to be at the thrift store. And he found this particular work in the southern United States. And he's a World War. This particular piece is painted by a World War II veteran. So if you look at the piece, you're going to recognize the scene. The scene, of course, is Omaha Beach, June 6, 1944. And this particular piece is pretty highly recognizable. Some of you who might be veterans or who like military collectibles might recognize this image because this image was reproduced in prints in large numbers. It's by an artist named Ken Riley. He's an American illustrator, very well known, and also a World War II veteran in and of his own right. Many of these great illustrators were on the battlefield and they would actually sketch these particular and important battles. This one shows you the attributes of first come, first serve. You know, like if you get there first, guess what? You're going to probably get something pretty interesting. So those prints of this image are still available. And what am I getting at? I'm getting at that this is the original oil on canvas of this very famous military image of June 6, 1944 in Omaha Beach, when, of course, the GIs start to take Normandy. It's unbelievable. This particular piece, I'll call the person who bought it, Andy. He paid $20 for it, and framed, it's worth $7,500. That's a real bargain of military collectibles. The next person I want to introduce you to, I'm going to call her Anne, is from Australia. And many, of course, of my YouTube followers are from all over the world. You know that I'm in the United States. But in fact, Anne wanted to tell me a little bit about something that she found. It's something she called an op shop. So I never heard of an op shop. And I said to Anne, you know, when I'm talking to you guys, I ask all kinds of questions. And it's fun to interact with all of you and learn more from you. I always say I learn as much from my audience as they learn from me. Sometimes more. And I said to Anne, I said, Anne, what's an op shop? She said, well, Dr. Lori, we call them opportunity shops in Australia. I was in Australia a few years ago. I loved Australia. The people were really, really nice. They were just nice, genuine, fun. And I had a wonderful time in Australia and also in New Zealand when I traveled there. But getting back, it's a long plane ride back. You're really tired. But it's a beautiful place, and there's lots of places to just walk and just look and sort of people watch. It was really a wonderful place. So she was in a part of Australia that I didn't go to. But this, I went to Sydney, and she was in a different part of Australia. And she went into this opportunity shop, and she says she goes there every once in a while, and she got this little trinket box. Now, you've seen trinket boxes. You know, you open them up, they sit on a dresser, you put your little baubles in it. Maybe it's earrings, or maybe, you know, I don't know, something else that you might have. Maybe you have an extra safety pin, and you put that in a trinket box, whatever it might be. So this little trinket box she picks up, and I said to her when I saw it, I said, oh, it has a nice cherub on the front of it, and it's Vaseline shape, which means it's kind of in the shape of a vase, a Vaseline shape. Not Vaseline like petroleum jelly, but Vaseline. So this particular piece, when you open up the trinket box, then you have this nice interior of the flower, and of course it has this metal all the way around. So she says that she bought it for $5 at the opportunity shop, which in American dollars is somewhere around $3.65 or 68 cents, something like that. So she gets this particular piece and I start to look at it and I said, well, can I see the back? So you've heard about trinket boxes, sometimes called Limoges boxes. They're called Limoges boxes because these particular boxes are made typically or introduced typically in the 1700s in Limoges, France. So they're usually French boxes, and they're important because they relate to this sort of idea of Rococo design. You know, during the reign of Louis XV, 1715 to 1774, you've got all this kind of frou-frou stuff. It's just a lovely time. Everything's going well for the elite, anyway. If you're a peasant, then you're not doing too good. Anyway, so I say, can you turn it over so I can see if there's any mark? I look at the mark and it's these two interlaced L's. Well, I like L's, you know. Two interlaced L's, and that is actually the royal cipher mark for the French court. The Sèvres factory, the Vicennes factory and the Sèvres factory actually produced this particular box. So immediately, this hand-painted gilt box looks good, right? This hand-painted gilt box looks good. It's very good looking, it's very attractive, it's a cool shape, it's in good condition, it's high quality. But when I see the mark, I'm like, oh my gosh, look at the mark. The mark is fantastic and it tells the whole story. This mark has those two interlaced L's and then it has the letter N in the middle. The letter N is a date mark, which indicates that that particular piece was made in 1766, the year after kaolin, which is the material that you need to make very high quality porcelain. Kaolin is found near Limoges. So this is like some of the best pieces that you're going to be able to find of Limoges trinket boxes. And I'm not talking about 19th century, 1800s trinket boxes, and I'm not talking about 20th century trinket boxes that you can see that were traded, you know, in the 50s at Christmas. I'm talking about, this is a 1766 Limoges trinket box, hand-painted, hand-gilded, beautiful quality, made by the royal potters for royalty, for Louis XV would have made. These are the guys who would have made stuff for Louis XV and Madame de Pompadour, and she's got it for $5 in Australia at an op shop. So I learned what an op shop was, and Anne learned that her piece was worth $1,500 for a $5, well, a $3.60 if you're in U.S. dollars investment. That's a real bargain. This real bargain comes from someone I'm going to call Larry. And Larry found this contemporary painting. Now, I know a lot of you are trying to get information about paintings and prints, and I do videos about paintings and prints. So you've really got to watch those. There's a chock full of information about paintings and prints because many of you have things that are in frames and you don't know what they are, and then you try to Google an artist name and then you don't come up with anything. So I'm teaching you what to look for beyond the artist names. So you got to watch those videos. This is a contemporary piece. I like contemporary art. I don't mind abstractions or non-objective art. I look for the color. I like the texture. I like the feel of the brushstroke. But I've looked at a lot of art, so I can understand a lot of people prefer realism. I like realism too, but this particular piece is by an artist named Tim Yankee, and it's a relatively well-known piece. It came to me through an online appraisal. So someone who follows the videos and then, you know, shops a lot for his mom, actually. He's a young guy who shops a lot and gets a lot of paintings for his mom, usually at thrift stores. Found this particular piece at a thrift store, sent me a picture of it because he wanted to get some information about it. So he sends me the picture and I get back to him and I said, yeah, I said, we should talk about this particular piece. It's dated 2009. So, you know, you think, oh, it's so new, it can't be really worth much, but actually he got it for $25. And if you look at the frame, the frame is valuable, right? You gotta think about the frames being valuable, and that's what you have in this particular case. And you'll notice that this is called the Star of Alaska, and it has a lot of sort of the colors and the elements that you would see abstracted if you took a trip to, of course, Alaska. Tim Yankee's works are not only sold, of course, in places like, you know, the Inside Passage, Alaska, and such, but also sold internationally and oftentimes to the tourist trade. So you'll see a lot of them being traded. This is an original. It is not a print. It's an original work of art, and it is framed. It's relatively small scale for an abstract work, because sometimes these abstract paintings are really, really big. And this particular example, he paid $25 for it, and I helped him to identify it, tell you about the real value. And he said, well, Dr. Lori, he goes, you told me that it was worth $400, and I sold it for $400. So I'm trying to help all of you make this money by identifying these pieces and helping you to know where to market them. Really important. And then there's this one. We'll call the owner of this piece Al. Al goes around to old bookstores, and he looks for Dr. Seuss books. Now, you're looking at this image, you're going, that's not a Dr. Seuss book, Dr. Lori. But that's what Al was looking for. He was looking for Dr. Seuss. You know, the Cat in the Hat, you know, that kind of thing. You know, the sun is not sunny, it's too wet to play, stayed in the house, all that cold, cold, wet day. We stayed in the house, we stayed there, we stayed in the house, we had nothing to do. You didn't think I knew that, did you? Anyway, so I read it so many times to my nieces that I remembered the whole little thing. Anyway, it wasn't Dr. Seuss, but that's what he was looking for. He was looking for Dr. Seuss. And interestingly enough, what he found instead was Where the Wild Things Are. And he found it in an old bookstore, and he's looking around, and he offered to ship the book to me, for me to appraise it. And I said, don't ship the book to me, never ship the book to me, don't send anything to anybody, I won't receive the book. He said, but I want you to look at it, I want you to look at the condition. I said, I can do that through photographs and video, it's no problem, I do that way all the time. Don't send anybody your object, you may not get it back. You would for me, but you're not sending it to me because I'm not accepting it. So, anyway, he gets this book. He shows me this book. It has the dust cover. That's the paper cover on top of the hardcover book. It's dated to 1963 by Maurice Sendak. Where the Wild Things Are, one of the quintessential, very important, award-winning children's literature books, you know, ever. And it's a wonderful example. It's a beautiful piece. So this particular piece is really great, and it's in good shape. The spine is in good shape, which is actually stitched, right? In the 60s, they actually stitched the spines. And then he also had the dust cover. Inside, he had decorative end papers. That means if you just open the cover and you don't open any of the pages of the book, those end papers are decorated, and you can see that here with all those nice bright colored, you know, leaves and flower forms, right? And then you, or jungle forms, kind of jungle, forestry kind of thing. And then you also can see, of course, all of those famous illustrations from Sendak's masterpiece. He paid $10 for it. It's a real bargain. Worth $2,250 to, of course, children's book collectors. Ah, a wonderful real bargain. Lots of real bargains here. You can learn this. You can do this. I'm going to help you find those things at your thrift store, your flea market, your antique shop, and such. And then, of course, I'm going to identify them and appraise them, and you can make some money right there. I'm Dr. Lori. This is Real Bargains. Thanks so much for watching.